Oh, good day, YouTube. Today's video is going to be slightly different than some of the other videos that I've made. I want to do a review on the Sky Echo 2. Now, the Sky Echo 2 is the world's first commercially available portable ADS-B in and out system. It transmits your position to other aircraft in your vicinity up to about 40 square miles. Letting them know your altitude, your height, and your position. And like vice versa, their aircraft will appear on your iPad, if you've got one, letting you know roughly their location as well. So I decided I actually wanted to give this a go just to see how actually effective it was. Around Europe can have quite busy airspace sometimes. But on the day I was going to actually use it, it was absolutely a beautiful day for flying. Freezing cold, icy cold, but there was hardly a breath of fresh air. So I decided I was going to do a rather long flight, and I would fly down to Mount Cook. I'd fly around Mount Cook. It's an area I'd always wanted to be in before. So I thought I'd give it a go, and I thought there'd be lots of commercial activity around there as well. So it'd be a good chance to actually test the equipment. Now, unfortunately, not everything always goes according to plan, and this flight was no different. By the time I got to Mount Hutt, my first camera failed, and I think it was just due to the cold. I had used it sparingly. It was the camera that's actually on the wing, and it just suddenly died on me around Mount Hutt when I turned it on. I just don't think it could withstand the cold temperatures. I did have a second camera available, which was mounted on my crossbar, and so I thought I wouldn't use that until I actually got to Mount Cook. And but when I did switch it on, it came up with 30% battery power, and then that camera also died just about 20 seconds later. So I had traveled 200 kilometers and now I had no cameras. But then I had a thought. I did have a cell phone. So the video you're about to see is of very, very poor quality. I got it out. I could only shoot a couple minutes at a time before my hands went numb. And then I couldn't feel the camera. I was flying above 10,000 feet and it was freezing and I couldn't feel the camera. And the last thing I wanted to do was to actually let go of the camera and have it go back through my prop. That'd be enough to spoil your day. So I got a few minutes footage out of this. But I also noticed as well, as I was just putting the camera in and out, how out of breath I got. And seeing most of the flight was done at around 10 or above 10,000 feet, I don't know whether or not it's just due to the icy cold conditions or whether or not it was due to the altitude. I'm not too sure. And it was around the same time as this that I started to get unusual fuel flow readings on my screen on the trike. When I planned for this, I was planning on, realistically, I thought I'd use about 9 liters per hour. I was conservative and I allowed up to 11 liters per hour. But now I'm suddenly getting readings of between 20 and 30 litres an hour of fuel usage on the display, which I knew wasn't right because the engine seemed to be running really, really well. However, it placed enough doubt in me and not having any cameras to actually turn around and head back. So we did make it to Mount Cook, but we just did a U-turn and came straight back. And ironically, well, not ironically really, I suppose, on the way back, then the iPad also died. I'm not too sure if any listeners have any good tips on how you can protect your equipment from the cold. So I ended up in the end, I mean, when you are using electronic flight bags, I use Avplan. When you are using those, I mean, CAA rules state that you must have a secondary device or a secondary, preferably a map as a backup. Having a map in a trike is not most practical, but I did have my cell phone with the app on, and so I had to actually finish the flight using the cell phone map. So there's a few little issues, but I was very pleased with how the Sky Echo went, and particularly on the return back from when I was around Mount Hutt, there was another aircraft who was making very clear and precise radio calls, but the Sky Echo told me his exact position, and I was able to change course and deviate because of that. It certainly takes a lot of the guesswork out, but obviously, because not all aircraft use this technology, you can't always rely upon it. Currently, you can't use the Sky Echo within controlled airspace. Hopefully one day that will actually change. It does have a built-in altimeter, but because that is preset at a set altitude, and the radar technology does not alter that, there can be a discrepancy in altitude. So it will give you an exact position of somebody, but the altitude, depending upon the day, could be out plus or minus 500 feet. So that is one of the disadvantages of using it. Christchurch radar, when it picks you up, because it is an EC device, the Christchurch radar will automatically downgrade the signal and you'll appear on its primary radar instead. So what will happen is you can actually appear just as a blip rather than having your speed and altitude and all that sort of stuff being displayed. But apart from that, it is actually a very, very handy thing to actually have within G airspace.
Yankee, Romeo Delta Yankee, Romeo Delta 7, second hand. Microlight 07 gate back 82, I took a pass at Amber Frank.
Okay, I've only just touched upon the usefulness of Sky Echo 2. It transmits and receives ADS-B information at 1090 MHz to other aircraft using similar technology. It has a range of 40 miles. It has an integrated TSO-certified GPS and barometric altimeter. It enhances your situational awareness. It has a battery life that allows 12 hours of continuous use. It provides proximity warnings. It's currently only for use in an uncontrolled Class G airspace. It has the added benefit of showing up on Flight Radar 24, which is good for family members when they want to know where your current location is. It will display your position on radar, and it retails for Australian $870, but is eligible for $560 government rebate here in New Zealand.